Hello.
Hi.
I'm Anne-Sophie.
And I am Marianne.
We will show you around in our bacteriology laboratory. We will explain you how to work up a blood culture.
From the reception of the blood culture bottle in the laboratory until identifying the bacteria to antibiotic susceptibility testing.
In this video, you will see BacteriAlert blood culture bottles of Biomérieux. However, in your hospital, you might have a different brand, like Bactec of Becton Dickinson. These bottles are designed for use in automated equipment. However, we validated the incubation of BacteriAlert bottles in a conventional incubator with visual inspection for growth.
Instead, you can have bottles designed for use in a conventional incubator. They can be commercial or homemade, containing a broth and sometimes an agar slant.
After blood culture sampling, blood cultures need to be stored at room temperature until arrival at the bacteriology laboratory. The maximum delay between sampling and incubation in the automated BacteriAlert incubator is 4 hours, in order to avoid false negative results. Other systems may have other instructions.
Upon arrival, the label of the bottle is compared to the laboratory request form to avoid errors. To control the sample blood volume, bottles are weighed before and after sampling. Every bottle is registered in the laboratory information system. This can either be digital or on paper.
Depending on the system available, bottles are incubated at 36 degrees in an automated incubator or a conventional incubator. In the conventional incubator, blood cultures are incubated for 7 days. Signs of growth are checked at regular time points of the day. During the first 3 days, we check every morning and evening. During the remaining 4 days, we check every morning.
Signs of growth are turbidity, hemolysis, color changes in the medium, gas production, pellicle or film formation, visible colonies like puffballs. In case of biphasic bottles, you can also see colony growth on the solid agar. For BacteriAlert bottles, the color indicator at the bottom of the bottle will change to yellow.
Automated incubators continuously monitor the blood culture bottles for signs of growth and have a more sensitive detector than the human eye. In case of growth, the automate will give a signal.
Blood culture bottles with signs of growth are taken out of the incubator and are processed over the following days to identify the bacteria present. In parallel, the antibiotic susceptibility of the bacteria is determined. The first step on the day of growth is to perform a Gram stain. The Gram is a differential stain that enables classification of bacteria into two large groups, the Gram-negative and the Gram-positive bacteria. The cell wall of Gram-positive and Gram-negative bacteria have a different structure and will react differently to the stain. A correct result of the Gram stain is important for the identification process of bacteria, as the next steps of identification depend on this result. How is a Gram stain made? One loopful of the blood culture broth is smeared on a microscopic slide in a biosafety cabinet if available. Next, the slide is fixated and stained. The result is read with the microscope. The Gram stain result is reported to the clinician as soon as possible, preferably by telephone call. The clinician adapts its antibiotic treatment accordingly. The second step on the day of growth is to obtain colonies of the bacteria to perform identification tests. To obtain single colonies, blood culture broth is subcultured on general and on selective culture media. General media allow most bacteria to grow. Examples are sheep blood agar and chocolate agar. Blood agar contains sheep blood, whereas chocolate agar contains heated and thus hemolyzed sheep blood. Selective media only allow growth of a specific group of bacteria and inhibit growth of other bacteria. An example is McConkie medium with crystal violet, which only allows growth of Gram-negative bacteria and inhibits growth of Gram-positive bacteria. Inoculated plates are incubated overnight.
We are now the second day after growth of the blood culture. Inoculated culture plates are checked for growth with bacteria visible as colonies on the plate. These colonies are used to perform further steps of identification. The aspect of the colonies gives you a first ID. For example, Staphylococcus aureus will present with hemolysis. Bacillus cereus has a typical wax-like appearance, and Klebsiella species have very mucoid colonies. On the selective McConkie medium, only gram-negative bacteria will grow, and the color of the colonies allows a categorization in lactose-fermenting or non-fermenting bacteria. Identification of the grown colonies can be done in a couple of minutes, using mass spectrometry, known as MALDI-TOF. In most laboratories, however, automated equipment is not available and biochemical tests are used. The choice of tests depends on the gram stain result and the growth characteristics as shown on the general and the selective media. Most biochemical tests require overnight incubation. The combination of different test results will be matched to a species identification. This identification result is reported to the clinician. In parallel with the identification tests, the antibiotic susceptibility of the bacteria is determined. There are three possible susceptibility categories. Either the strain is susceptible to a specific antibiotic and the therapy will be effective to clear the infection, or the strain is intermediately susceptible to a specific antibiotic and the therapy will only be effective in increased doses. Or the strain is resistant to a specific antibiotic and the therapy will not be effective to clear the infection.
There are two possible methods for antibiotic susceptibility testing, the disc diffusion method and the E-test. For disc diffusion, a standardized bacterial suspension is spread on a specific solid culture medium. Antibiotic discs, impregnated with a specific antibiotic, are placed on top of the medium. The plates are incubated overnight. During overnight incubation, the antibiotic diffuses through the agar around the disc while the strain is also growing. If the strain is susceptible for the antibiotic in the disc, it will not be able to grow close to the disc. In that case, you can see an area without growth around the antibiotic disc. This is called an inhibition zone. After incubation, the diameter of the inhibition zone is measured. The diameter is a measure for the susceptibility of the bacterium to the antibiotic and is compared to breakpoints in reference guidelines to define the susceptibility category. The E-test is a method based on a combination of dilution and disc diffusion. It determines the minimal inhibitory concentration of a particular antibiotic. Similar to disc diffusion, a standardized suspension of the bacterium is spread on the surface of a specific solid culture medium. Next, instead of a disc, a thin strip impregnated with a dried exponential gradient of the tested antibiotic is placed on top. The antibiotic is immediately released onto the culture medium, creating an exponential gradient of the antibiotic in the culture medium underneath the strip. The plates are incubated overnight. When the bacterial growth becomes clear, a symmetrical ellipse-shaped inhibition zone is visible. The higher the concentration of the antibiotic, the larger the zone of inhibition. The minimal inhibitory concentration is red at the intersection of the ellipse and the strip.
Antibiotic susceptibility results are communicated to the clinician as soon as possible. Only useful information concerning the patient's treatment options is communicated. This is called conditional or selective antibiotic reporting. All antibiotics to which the bacteria are resistant are reported. If the bacteria are susceptible to first-line small-spectrum antibiotics, only first-line antibiotics will be reported. If bacteria are resistant to first-line antibiotics, second-line antibiotics will be reported. The choice of antibiotics to test and to report depends on the local epidemiology and the local availability of antibiotics. Therefore, details of testing and reporting of antibiotics are discussed with the Hospital Antibiotic Stewardship Committee involving clinicians and pharmacists.
We hope this video helped you to understand how the bacteriology laboratory processes blood cultures and how it contributes to treatment management of patients with a suspected bloodstream infection.